Hello all, very good morning. From today onwards we are going to resume our regular classes. Till now we have discussed the epidemiological diseases. In that we have discussed regarding communicable diseases, and from those communicable diseases I am going to discuss regarding intestinal infections. In intestinal infections we are going to discuss cholera. So today our topic is on cholera. Coming to the cholera, what is this cholera? It is an acute diarrheal disease and it is mainly caused by the organism called as Vibrio cholerae. The cases are mainly ranging from asymptomatic to severe. What it is stating? The cases can be asymptomatic and the cases can be also at a very severe stage. Coming to the symptoms, so if there are typical cases, if there is severity in a case, you can observe these following signs and symptoms. So there will be sudden onset of profuse, effortless, watery diarrhea. And it is followed by vomiting, rapid dehydration, muscle cramps and suppression of urine. So these are the symptoms. So whenever you are finding a case with acute diarrheal symptoms, with acute diarrheal distress, you can classify with these signs and symptoms. If you observe these following signs and symptoms, you can classify it as a severity of the disease, and you can consider it as a disease which is caused by cholera. So unless and until we are unable to maintain the rehydration, while the patient is losing her body fluids through watery diarrhea, if you are failing to replace those lost fluids, the patient may end up in death. So it may be as high as 30 to 40%. Why the patient is going to die? Why the fatality rate is increasing here? As the patient is losing her water, body fluid levels and electrolytes, which are essential for normal function of the body, if they are not being replaced at a appropriate time, the patient may land up in fatality. Coming to the problem statement of this disease, cholera. So this cholera, it is present in India since ancient times. So it is not a new topic or it is not a new disease. It was present in India since ancient times, and during 19th century there was a severe pandemic which had occurred in India, and from India this disease got spreaded to the western countries also. And currently the seventh pandemic, it had begun in the year 1961 in Indonesia. In which country? In Indonesia. And this pandemic had involved more than 80 countries. Countries including from Asian continent, African continent and European continent. So in this pandemic, there is the organism Vibrio cholerae had modified its structure to LTR Vibrio, and it has caused a great extent of damage to the humankind. And India, this pandemic began in which year? In 1961. In which country? In Indonesia. And this pandemic, and this pandemic and this pa- in which year? So the this pandemic had begun in which year? In it had begun in the year 1961. In which country? In Indonesian country. So this pandemic had affected India in the year 1964. Although it had begun in the year 1961, it had taken 2 years to cross and contaminate India. So this epidemic of cholera are very frequent, striking adults as well as children. So these epidemics of cholera are always very frequent and they are striking both adults and children. Epidemiological studies have shown that cholera is responsible for about 5 to 10% of acute diarrheal cases in non-epidemic situation. So what they are saying, in non-epidemic situations, about 5 to 10% of acute diarrhea cases are mainly caused due to the Vibrio cholerae. So a new strain of cholera, which is named as 0139, emerged in India in 1992. What happened in 1992? There is a new strain of this Vibrio cholerae. It spreaded to West Pakistan and East Bangladesh. It had spreaded to West Pakistan and East Bangladesh. In early months of 1993, it has caused more than 1 lakh cases and 10,000 deaths in southern Bangladesh. What happened in the year 1993? There were more than 1 lakh cases which were involved in the disease cholera, and this disease had caused about 10,000 deaths in southern Bangladesh. So recent studies are indicating that global warming, it is a favorable condition for these bacteria to grow. So the cholera transmission is closely linked to inadequate environmental management. Typical at-risk areas include peri-urban slums with poor basic infrastructure. So typically which areas are affected? Mainly the slums, urban slums are affecting. A level of such instance could be due to consequences of disaster disruption of water and sanitation system, or due to displacement of population due to inadequate and overcrowding. So what kind of situations are favoring these conditions? They are mainly due to the disaster disruption of water. What happening if the people in the urban slums are closely related, they are tightly packed together. So the water which they are containing, if one person is contaminating the water, if the water is contaminated by this organism, mostly the onset of symptoms will be very high, and it can cause fatality to those overcrowded people. Coming to the epidemiological features, I am discussing about features. So it can be epidemic, it can be an endemic. Cholera is both epidemic and endemic. So the endemicity and epidemicity depends upon the favorable conditions. They are depending upon the favorable condition and the type of organism which is affecting the patient. The characteristics of the agent influencing its distribution. Include ability to survive, its virulence, average number of organisms required to cause the infection. So what are the characteristics of the organism which are influencing? Its ability to survive, and its virulence stage, and its capacity to infect the persons. Epidemics of cholera are characteristically abrupt and can cause an acute health problem. What it is saying? So whenever there is an epidemic of this cholera, it is very abrupt in stage, means sudden onset it is occurring, and it is causing health problem to the public. The epidemics have potential. So these epidemics are having great potential to reach their peaks, and they will subside gradually as the force of infection declines. They are subsiding gradually as the force of infection is declining. So in what is happening, when oftentimes by the time control measures are instituted, the epidemic has already reached its peak and is waning. So what is happening? If we are planning to control the infection, so by the time we recognize the infection in the public, it is reaching its peak and it is coming down. Thus, cholera epidemic in a country is self-limiting. What is happening? So when a cholera is occurred in a country, it could be a self-limiting disease. It tends to decline after reaching its peak. So what is happening? Whenever it is reaching its peak, slowly, gradually, it start to decrease. Slowly and gradually, it is starting to decrease. So the force of infection is composed of two components, namely the force of infection through water and force of infection through living components. So how the disease is being spread? Mainly through infection through contact and infection through water. So we are all very fine that it is the elimination of contaminant. It is mainly spread through the contaminated water. So if you are able to disinfect the contaminated water, or if you are able to prevent the contamination of the water, the disease outbreak can be prevented. The disease outbreak can be prevented. So it undergoes seasonal fluctuations as well as epidemic outbreaks. The seasonal variation differ between countries and even between regions of same country. The seasonal incidence is also subjected to. So what the above statement is stating? The above statement is stating the seasonal variations differs between countries and even between regions of the same country. So the seasonal variations are very different from country to country. Even in country, it is different between regions to region. So the disease used to be most common in the summer in Calcutta. In Calcutta, you can see the disease cholera most commonly in summer. And in Bangladesh, you can see it in early winter. Now in both places, it is most frequent in autumn. In some parts of India, the peak incidence is in August. So what is happening? It is varying from region to region in some areas. For example, if you take Calcutta, in summer region, the incidence of this cholera is at a high peak. In Bangladesh, it is at early winter. And what happened now? These both areas are having this, means the cases of this cholera are seen in which season? They are seen in autumn. They are seen in autumn. And in India, in some part of the patient, it is most commonly occurring in August. So coming to the epidemiological determinants, what are the epidemiological determinants? Epidemiological determinants include agent factors, environmental factors, and host factors. So what is this agent factor? What is this agent factor? The agent that causes cholera is named as Vibrio cholerae. What is the agent that causes cholera? The agent that causes cholera is Vibrio cholerae. The term epidemic strain has also been used for this Vibrios. The term epidemic strain has been also used for this Vibrios. Coming to the resistance of this organism Vibrio cholerae, if you are able to heat the organism for 30 minutes at the temperature of 50 degrees Celsius, we can kill this organism. And if you are boiling it for few seconds also, you can kill the organism. And this organism can sustain ice for more than 4 to 6 weeks or sometimes longer also. So exposing this organism to dry sun and drying the organism will kill the organism within few hours. And these are very easily destroyed. You can use the disinfectant such as Crisol, and you can use the disinfectant such as Crisol and bleaching powder. Bleaching powder ratio is about 6 milligrams per 1 liter. Coming to the toxin production of the organism. So what is this organism? It is mainly infecting the intestines. So you can see here, Vibrios most multiply in small intestinal lumen and produce an exotoxin. It is multiplying in the small intestinal lumen and they are producing an exotoxin. This toxin produces diarrhea through. This toxin is mainly producing the diarrhea through what? Through its effect on adenylate, cyclase, cyclic, mainly AMP system of mucosal cells of the small intestine. In simple words, you can say this toxin is affecting the mucosal cells of small intestine, which is leading to acute diarrhea. The endotoxin has no effect on the other tissues except on the intestinal epithelial cells. So the endotoxin which is produced, they are mainly affecting the intestinal epithelial cells but not the other tissues. Coming to the reservoir of infection, the human being is only the known reservoir. He may be a case or he may be a carrier. Coming to the cases, range from inapparent infection to severe ones, as I said in earlier. In cholera, LTOR, most infections are mild and asymptomatic. What happened? In cholera, if it is Vibrio cholerae, the symptoms may be severe or moderate. But if the cholera is due to LTOR cholerae, the symptoms may be mild or sometimes it may be asymptomatic also. It is the mild and asymptomatic cases that play significant role in maintaining endemic reservoir. So these mild and asymptomatic cases, they are playing a major role in causing a reservoir. These people are able to infect the other persons very easily. Coming to the carriers. Carriers are usually temporary and rarely they are in chronic stage. They make an important contribution to the reservoir of infection. What they are making? They are making an important contribution to the reservoir of infection through which the disease is being spread. Since carriers excrete fewer vibrios than clinical cases, carriers are best detected by the bacteriological examination of the purge stool induced by administration of 30 to 60 grams of magnesium sulfate in 100 ml of water by mouth. So what is happening? These carriers, they are excreting fewer vibrios. So if you are able to give them this magnesium sulfate 100 ml of water, that is 30 to 60 grams, you can see in bacteriological examination what is the organism which is causing the disease. So coming to the infective material, so what is the infective material here? The immediate source of infection, mainly the stools and vomits of cases and carriers, and large number of vibrios, that is from 10 to the power of 7 to 10 to the power of 10 vibrios per 1 ml of fluid are present in water stools of patients. So if there is large number of excretion of these vibrios, they are able to infect the other person. And an average patient excretes about 10 to 20 liters of fluid. How much fluid they are excluding? They are excreting about 10 to 20 liters of fluid during this epidemic or acute diarrheal disease. Carriers excrete fewer vibrios than cases. Carriers are excreting fewer vibrios than cases, means 10 to the power of 2 to 10 to the power of 5 vibrios per 1 ml of stool. Coming to the infective dose, cholera is dose related. The infection occurs when there is large number of vibrios ingested, excretes the dose that is infective for the individual. So what is this statement is saying? If a case or carrier is excreting more than 10 to the power of 7 to 10 to the power of 10 number of vibrios in a watery stool for 1 ml of stool, per 1 ml of stool or per 1 gram of stool, then the patient will get this infection. If it is less than those 10 to the power of 7 to 10 to the power of 10, then the patient may be he may not get infected. So what it is saying, what is this infective dose? The amount of, the number of organisms which are required to infect the person, it is considered as a infective dose. Experiment suggests that in a normal person, a very high dose of 10 to the power of 11 organism is required to produce clinical disease. So what these examinations are showing, if the vibrio cholerae is coming and attacking a normal person, he or she may needs 10 to the power of 11 organisms to exhibit the signs and symptoms of cholerae. Coming to the period of communicability, a case of cholera is infectious for a period of 10 to 7 days. For how many days? For 7 to 10 days, the case of cholera is being infected. Convalescent carriers are infectious for 2 to 3 weeks. The chronic carrier state may last from a month up to 10 years or sometimes more also. Coming to the carriers in cholera, a cholera carrier may be defined as an apparently healthy person who is excreting vibrio cholerae. Means this person is not showing any kinds of signs and symptoms, but whenever he is going for stools, he is excreting the organism which is known as vibrio cholerae. So there are mainly four types of cholera carriers that had been described: preclinical or incubatory carriers, second one is convalescent carriers, and third one is contact or health carriers, and fourth one is chronic carriers. Coming to the preclinical or incubatory carriers, the incubatory carriers are potential patients. What are these incubatory carriers? These are potential patients. Since the incubation period of cholera is about 1 to 5 days, incubatory carrier stage is also very short duration. So what is this term? Preclinical or incubatory carriers. If a person is infected with this Vibrio cholerae during the development of the organism in the person's body, the person is becoming an infective person and he is able to transmit the disease from one person to another person. And this disease transmission is very short. This period of communicability means incubatory carriers, period of communicability is very short. Why? Because they are, the incubation period is about 1 to 5 days only. So the shorter the duration of incubation period, the shorter the duration of this carrier state. Coming to the convalescent carriers, what are these convalescent carriers? The patients who are recovered from the attack of cholerae, even though they are recovered from the attack of cholerae, these people still excrete vibrios. For the period of 2 to 3 weeks. This period of 2 to 3 weeks is known as convalescence period. So convalescent state had been reported among patients who are not received effective antibiotic treatment. So if any patient who is affected with this cholera is not receiving proper antibiotic treatment, then the patient may land up in a state which is known as convalescent state. He may not show any kind of signs and symptoms, but he is excreting the Vibrio cholerae organisms. The convalescent carriers can be often become chronic or long-term carriers. What is happening? These convalescent carriers, they may become chronic or sometimes long-term carriers. Contact or health carriers. The third one is contact or health carriers. This is the result of subclinical infection contracted through association of source of infection. The duration of the contact carrier state is usually less than 10 days. The gallbladder is not infected and stool culture is frequently positive for vibrios. The fourth one is chronic carrier state. The chronic carrier state occurs infrequently. It is occurring very infrequently. In this chronic carrier state, the gallbladder is infected. In these cases, antibody titer against Vibrio cholerae 0.1 raises and remains positive. What is happening? Whatever the antibodies we are giving, the organism is able to sustain the antibody treatment and they will remain positive as long as the person is harboring that organism. I'll conclude this session here. In next session, we are going to discuss regarding the host factors, mode of transmission and environmental factors which are favoring the disease and control of cholerae.